All right. So terrific. Thank you all for joining us for another MAD Plus seminar hosted by Itteha Zurich and NYU. Today, we're very excited to have Sarah Vanda here from Itteha Zurich, who's going to be talking to us. Sarah is one of the leaders in mathematical statistics across the world. She's, I think, someone who has really added a lot to our fundamental understanding, particularly of M estimation, which is, you know, maybe the most ubiquitous manner of doing statistical estimation possible. And she was also, she has been someone who's really helped us to understand the interactions between empirical process theory and statistical estimation. These are fundamental ideas that people in this field are using every day. So Sarah's won a ton of awards. She was an invited speaker at ICM in 2010, former president of the Bernoulli Society. And something that made a big impact on me when I was a grad student is I remember looking up once that her very first paper in the Annals of Stats has the title, A New Approach to Least Squares Estimation. So if any of us is lucky enough to bring new insights to something as classical as least squares estimation, we should count ourselves as being really making fundamental contributions to the field. So I'm excited to hear what Sarah has to say today. She's going to be telling us about TV regularization. Take it away.
Okay, thank you very much, Jonathan. Is the sound okay?
It's perfect.
Yeah.
Oh, that was a really nice introduction. And actually, this talk will again be about least squares estimation. So I'm a bit stuck in that field. Anyway, so it's a joint work with Francesco Ortelli, who's a PhD student. Let me see. And here's a little bit the contents. So it's theoretical work. I'm not going to introduce new algorithms or methods on adaptive estimation with strong links with the lasso. So lasso is least squares with L1 penalty and basis pursuit. So that's minimum norm estimation, which is somehow now more in focus again in relation with neural networks. The emphasis will be on interpolating vectors, and they lead to a so-called sparsity concept, which I call effective sparsity. So sparsity is a major ingredient. And the examples will be trend filtering, image reconstruction, and total variation on graphs. So let's see. So here's the model. So I'm just looking at the simplest possible case. That's the signal plus noise model. We have a vector y of observations, which is in n-dimensional space. And the mean of y is an unknown vector, which I call f0. It's a vector. Sometimes I refer to it as a function. That's just for speech. And then the variable is Gaussian. So I assume the noise epsilon to be standard Gaussian, also just for simplicity. So we want to estimate the signal f0. And for that, we use the analysis approach. The analysis problem is that you think that certain linear combinations of the signal are zero. So there are certain, you take certain linear combinations, it's here, and you take the L1 penalty to induce that most of these linear combinations are zero in the estimator. So the matrix D is called an analysis matrix, and it's given, it depends on the problem. And then there's a tuning parameter, lambda. Okay, so it's just the lasso in disguise. So examples are total variation, then the matrix D is like this incidence matrix of a path graph. And what you do is you look at the increments of the vector and you sum them up, and you look at the absolute value and you sum them up. And that's called the total variation. So it's a discrete version of total variation. Another example is total variation on graphs. So you have nodes And at each node, you observe a certain value y, and you want to estimate the mean. And you believe that if there is an edge between two nodes, that then these means will be similar. So then you use total variation on graphs. You can also look at higher order total variation. I put down here a reference, Deep Shirani, Ryan. He has lots of very important work for trend filtering. So there's a lot of theory about that. So instead of just looking at first order differences, you can also look at higher order differences, say the kth order difference, where k is some prescribed number which you take. For instance, k equals to 2 is very interesting because then you get a linear piecewise linear estimators. And so the total variation of the k minus 1 discrete derivative is then, well, it's the L1 norm of the kth discrete derivative that can be in the penalty. Finally, total variation in higher dimensions that could be defined in various ways. The one I'll consider is Hardy-Krause variation, which is just thinking of, you think of a grid. At each point you observe a value y and you think that the mean, behaves like a measure, so to speak, but it's a signed measure, that the measure of such a little square is not too large, so that the sum of those measures is bounded, say. And then total variation. This is a special case of a graph, total variation on the grid, where you look at the differences in the direction to the left and downstairs. Yeah? So this is like taking the derivative with respect to x and with respect to y and summing that all up. And then you to put it in the penalty. So these are the kind of problems that I want to consider. And before giving you the aim, what I want to show, I need some notation. So you have this given analysis matrix D. It has n columns and m rows. And you apply it to the signal f or some function f. And what you get is a m-dimensional vector, which I call b. I call b the vector of coefficients, somewhat in terminology of regression. So this coefficient vector is m-dimensional from Mary. And then for a subset, which could be like the active set of some target, I define B of S as the set of coefficients inside the set S, and B of minus Z, the set of coefficients outside the set S. Now, let's see. So if you have a signal F, it can be that its coefficients are zero outside the set S. I call that the null set, and the dimension of the null set I call R of S, R for rank, say, so to speak. So the aim is then to show that the estimator has, well, let's call it the prediction error, that the prediction error is order the dimensionality of the problem divided by the number of observations. So indeed, if you look at the true signal, then its active set is the one where the coefficients are non-zero. And so outside this active set, the coefficients are zero. So the true signal is in this null space. So the true signal has this dimension R of S zero. Okay, so that makes sense then that this is your aim, just the number of parameters, so to speak, divided by the number of observations. But in fact, I will not reach this goal. I will have some log terms, and sometimes there will also, well, often there will be further issues here. So that's what I'll be talking about. Yeah, but the idea is the following. Suppose you have as penalty the total variation, straight total variation. And the true signal is like this, piecewise constant with two jumps. Okay, then the dimensionality of the problem is 3 because you have those two jumps and you have the constant term. So three is finite. Let's say it keeps to be finite. So I want them to show the parametric rate modulo some log terms. Now this is notation with order symbols just to get the idea, but I'm not going to do asymptotics in that sense. It will be all non-asymptotic, but this makes the result a bit more transparent. Okay, if you have a piecewise linear function and you take as a penalty second order differences, well, piecewise linear, then there are a certain number of kinks, and there's the constant term and the linear term. So this function lives in the space with dimensionality 4, say, so it's again finite. So you want to prove a parametric rate. For the Hardy-Krause variation, where you look sort of at the measure of these little squares, I'm not sure, but this is a very simple picture. I think the dimensionality is probably 4. I just started doubting again, but I think it's 4. So again, finite, it's a simple picture. So you want a parametric rate. Yeah, without knowing a priori, of course, that it is that simple. That's the adaptivity of the whole thing. Again, for total variation on the grid, suppose your pink picture is very simple. Okay, then you say, okay, it's blue, oh, purple or red, two colors, so that's dimension 2. So you want the rate of convergence to be parametric. You can also say, oh, well, but if I move from red to purple, there is a jump. And if it's a square picture, then this is square root n, that's square root n. So you will have square root n little jumps here. So maybe the rate is the number of jumps divided by the number of observations. Or maybe it's something else. So it's not so clear. So that's what I'll come to if there's time. Okay. So before going on, let me give the result that I'm heading at, and of which I want to apply then, of course. So it goes like this. Let blue f be some vector. This is potential in Oracle, because I'm going to, you can choose it in such a way that it trades off approximation error and estimation error. So in principle, it's arbitrary. Let blue s be its active set. You can extend that, but let's say it's exactly its active set. Okay, then we take some parameters, u and v, which determine, u determines the confidence level and v also the confidence level of what's going to come. You take your tuning parameter depending on this u, which I have to explain, but that will come later. And then with large probability, the prediction error is bounded by the approximation error, so that's the difference between the oracle and the truth, plus a term which you can think of as the estimation error. And that contains the dimension of the oracle. Yeah, so this is number of parameters divided by number of observations, and then there's a square there. So that's good. This is a parametric term, which is also fine. And this then, this is what I want to talk about. This is the square of the effective sparsity. And that's what I have to explain. This is related with the restricted eigenvalues, but it's a little bit an extension of that. Okay, so this theorem, I should refer to the paper by Dalalian and co-authors, because it's very much related. It's a little bit more general, but the ideas actually from this paper. Okay, so I have to explain effective sparsity now.
One quick question, Sarah. Yeah. So are you again hiding log factors here, or there's really no logs in this?
No, this is the log factors are in the here in this lambda. In the tuning parameter, there's a log factor, and in the effective sparsity, it all depends.
I see. Okay.
So this is just no hiding, no log factors hiding here. Yeah, good point. Okay, so which is no surprise, but it's still nice to point out, is that you write down the KKT conditions to get some kind of basic inequality. So that's not so difficult. But what occurs in this basic inequality is quite obviously the difference between the L1 norms of the oracle and the estimator. And to go on now with this inequality, you need a bound for that difference. And for that, there's a very simple method. It goes as follows. You say, okay, I have, well, let's say the oracle is the true vector, just not to confuse us. So suppose you look at the true signal, and at its active set, it's non-zero. And so there it has a sign plus or minus one, and call that Q of S0. And outside the set S0, outside the active set, you don't require anything except that Q has to be bounded by one in absolute value. And we call this Q now an interpolating vector. And the difference between these L1 norms is just the inner product of D transpose Q and F0 minus F. That's really quite trivial, but I will not go into the proof because of time, but it's really not a deep observation. Okay, and I'm not the first to observe it. So before going on with the topic, let me just, as a motivating example, look at basis pursuit, because there you can explain the idea of interpolating factors, so that Q, I can explain that in without having to do with noise. And a noiseless problem where this is interesting is basis pursuit. So you are given now the vector. You observe it with noise, but it's just given. And you are also given a matrix n times p now. And then you want to minimize the L1 norm of the coefficient such that the linear combination of the columns of x is exactly this vector which was prescribed. So I guess most people know basis pursuit. And then there are certain null space properties that ensure that you can do an exact recovery of B. Now here's some kind of analysis variant of that. You have a fixed matrix D, and you also fix a set of the entries of F0. And you want to now minimize D of F in L1 norm, subject to the function is the correct function at those points. So you fixed the vector at these black points. And then you want to minimize this L1 norm. So that's like a minimum norm solution that interpolates the data. Then suppose you indeed have a very clean interpolation, and you want to say, okay, this interpolation has the minimum norm. So the question is, when is the function you started with the minimum norm solution? And you can check it by just looking at this interpolating vector. If outside the set J is outside the set of these interpolating points, if it's zero there, then the function you started with is indeed a minimum norm solution. That's quite obvious, because if you look at this inequality, so inside the set J, F is equal to F0, and outside this part is zero. So then the whole thing is zero, and it's also bigger than zero. So they have to be equal. So this is just to motivate these interpolating vectors. But just as an example, suppose you look at the total variation. So you have, say, these three points. That's the set J, and then you do a piecewise constant interpolation. Well, the solution with minimum norm is not unique, of course, because you have this staircase effect. But still, it is a minimum norm solution, because if you look at the interpolating vector, you can just do the following. You say, okay, when there is a jump, I put a plus one if it's a jump up, and I put a minus one if it's a jump down, then it's this Q has the right signs at the active set. And otherwise, I just do a piecewise constant interpolation, making sure of the boundaries that it's fine. then if you do take d transpose q, well, d transpose is again taking something like first derivatives. And d transpose q is now zero because here it's zero because it's constant. And then there are some spikes here at the black points. But outside these black points, it's zero. So this f zero is a minimum norm solution. Here's another example. Suppose you have these black points and you do piecewise linear interpolation. Is that the minimum norm solution in terms of first order differences, second order differences? And the answer is yes. You can just do, you look where the kinks are and you put the plus or minus one depending on whether the first derivative has a positive or negative jump. Okay. And then you do now, instead of piecewise constant, you do linear interpolation. And then d transpose q is again, well, it's now the second order differences. So second derivatives of linear functions are zero. Outside the set J, it's zero. So the interpolation is indeed a minimum norm solution. So this is well-known theory, of course. This, you can look at the paper of Unser and co-authors. But maybe just the proof are maybe a little bit different. So with these piecewise linear functions, you can say, okay, well, the coefficients are just the second order differences, and the dictionary, the basis functions are these hinge functions, the ReLU activation functions. So it goes a little bit in the direction of neural networks with ReLU activation functions, but yeah, indeed there are some connections there, but this is of course one dimensional. So now we go back to our problem. So we look at the difference between L1 norms of coefficients, and you can we had this just this inner product here, and if you apply Cauchy-Schwarz there, you get the L2 norm of D transpose interpolating vector. And that's what I call effective sparsity if you square it. So it's the minimum over all vectors Q, such they have the right signs at S0, they're there plus or minus one, and otherwise they are bounded by one in absolute value. Yeah, so here are the plus and minus one where the active set is. And then you interpolate and you take d transpose q and then L2 norm squared of that. That's the effective sparsity. So why I call that sparsity, I'll show in a minute. But first, some examples. If you look at total variation, so suppose the function has one, two, three jumps. Then at the jumps up, you put the plus one, and at the jumps down, you put the minus one. And now instead of piecewise constant interpolation, I do a linear interpolation. And then d transpose q is the derivative, so to speak, of a linear function, which is piecewise constant, which is here. And the L2 norm of this function is the effective sparsity. So that's here. And of course, you see then if a function jumps from up to down, you have to cover all this distance from plus one to minus one, the distance two. And if they're very close together, then this will be a very steep slope. So then the derivative will be large. And that's why in effective sparsity occurs one over the distance between jumps. Except when the jumps are both in the same direction, because then you just can keep it constant, so then it doesn't matter. So for instance, if you have a function which is monotone, then the distance between jumps doesn't play a role. Now in this case, the dimensionality of the function is four, three jumps and the constant term. And this effective sparsity, if you're lucky, is also about that, if the distance between jumps is proportional to the sample size. Yeah, so, but of course, it's not exactly four, this, but it's maybe. So for piecewise linear functions, you have the same. You have these kinks, and you look at the kinks where the jumps are down or up for the first derivative. And instead of linear interpolation, you do quadratic interpolation. And the second derivative is then piecewise constant. And the effective sparsity involves the distance between kinks, but now to the power 3. This is an easy calculation. I'm not sure, I never proved that this is a tight upper bound, but seems to be. So just a few words, why do I call this effective sparsity? Well, if you have the trivial case where the analysis matrix is the identity, well, normalized by square root of n, then D transpose Q is just the L2 norm, which you can split into the norm inside the set S and outside. Inside the set S, it's plus or minus 1, so then the L2 norm squared is S. And the outside, you can minimize it by putting outside the set S to 0. So then the effective sparsity is the number of non-zeros. It's not the dimensionality of the problem, because D is not maybe penalizing everything. So there are some unpenalized coefficients. So that adds up to the total dimensionality. But this is the dimensionality of the penalized coefficients. Okay, so if there was no noise, then I replace Y here by the noiseless version, F0. And if you do then this analysis, well, it's not an estimator, but algorithm, you get this effective sparsity as upper bound times lambda squared. So this sort of means that effective sparsity is like the bias coming from the penalty. But now what about noise? Yeah, so we have to do something. Let's see, how much time do I have? Okay. So recall the estimator. Yeah? So D square estimator plus penalty. And then there's this KKT type inequality. And that has, of course, this noise term. And the whole reason why there is a penalty is, of course, because you want to overrule the noise term. So that means that the effective sparsity, which I introduced so far, is only useful for noiseless problems, but otherwise you have to change it and adjust it for noise. Okay. And that goes as follows. Suppose you have a linear space in n dimensions, then pi is going to be the projection on that space. And the projection of a vector on that space I write as f of subscript L. Okay. Then a vector in n-dimensional space, you can decompose in its projection on the null space, plus the projection on the orthocomplement of that, so the anti-projection, so to speak. Now this part, let's say this is the null space of the oracle, then you don't want to get rid of it, because that's just has the right dimension. So you only have to worry about this part. And for that part, we use a dictionary, psi, with coefficients b. And the dictionary consists of row vectors in n-dimensional space. And the dictionary is only useful for outside the active set, because inside you're already in the right set. And the length of these dictionary vectors, I call that the noise weights. Now we take a sort of noise level, which is the usual one if you look at the maximum of Gaussian random variables. So it's a bound for the maximum with confidence 1 minus e to the power minus u. So this parameter sort of involves the confidence in the statements that you are going to make. And then you have to take the tuning parameter, at least the maximum noise weight divided by the times the noise level. Okay, so far so good. Yeah. Okay, then the effective sparsity adjusted for noise again involves an interpolating vector. And what we do is, so we again put pluses or minuses at the active set. And then this purple one is, say, the interpolating vector when there was no noise. But because of the noise, we have to go down a little bit steeper here, or maybe much steeper. So it is the L2 norm of D transpose Q squared, where now outside the set S, Q has to be less than, really less than one, less than one minus W, and W is the our weights, which is just the noise weight times the noise level divided by lambda. And because we assumed lambda is larger than what's on top here, these weights are less than or equal to one. Okay, so in particular near the jumps, you want this not to go down maybe too quickly. That depends, of course, on the situation, but somehow this will make the effective sparsity adjusted for noise larger than the noiseless one. Okay, so this was the theorem I showed you before. And now I explained everything. I hope, so no log terms yet, but they will come. Oh, there was a log term here. Here you are. Here's a log term here. Here's one of the log terms. Okay. So this, now let's look at examples. The rest of the talk will be about examples. So total variation, it's quite well known. Then the before we said, okay, we look at where the jumps are and we do a linear interpolation. And then you get effective sparsity proportional to one over the distance between jumps. And now if there is noise, you have to go down a little bit more quickly to deal with the noise. And that is behaving like one minus square root of x or something like that. But the effect on the effective sparsity is just log terms. So there come another couple of log terms, Jonathan. So here's the idea. So you have for total variation, the dictionary is these bumps, I think they're called. So this red function is, say, an active dictionary element in the original dictionary, and the other ones are not active. And you project the other ones on the active ones. Well, you can just look at the distance. The distance between an active one and a non-active one, well, the L1 distance here is something like m. And the L2 distance is the square root of the L1 distance, so that's something like square root m. So if I go back, that's why you have here some decreasing in terms of one minus square root something. Okay, but that's where the logs come from. So for total variation, the application gives that you should take your tuning parameter at least the noise level, which is something like square root log n over n, times the maximal distance between jumps divided by n. Then you have this Oracle inequality, where the effective sparsity is, something like the harmonic mean, one of the harmonic mean of the jumps, but then with some log terms. And little s is here the sparsity, you could say, so the size of the active set S. Okay. And if the jumps are equally spaced, or more or less equally spaced, something like this, then you see that the effective sparsity is not S plus one. S plus one is the number of parameters, but it's S plus one squared and a log term. And the tuning parameter, however, again, cancels one of those squares. So if there are very many jumps, you have a smaller tuning parameter. you can choose a Smalling tuning parameter. And then if you do that, the rate of convergence is S plus 1 over N, number of parameters divided by number of observations, and then some log terms, where one log term can be removed by being a bit more precise. Okay, so this, so then in that sense, we have reached our aim here that the estimator adapts to the number of jumps. And the same is true for higher order discrete derivatives. Again, what occurs is the distance between jumps of the case minus one derivative. And the effective sparsity is involving powers of the distance between these jumps. Here's an important reference, just appeared in the annals, no, just a few months ago. So how does that go with these projections? So in, say, with the second order discrete derivatives, the dictionary is these ReLU functions. And the red one is an active one. And then you look at the distance between an active one and a non-active one, which can in principle be quite large, but if you just add a few constant functions to the basis, so you don't take exactly this space, which you just add a few functions without destroying the dimension too much, just say make the dimension twice as large. And then you get that these powers of m to the power 3. So that's why, let me go back here, you get d to the power 3 if k is equal to 2. So again, for higher order discrete derivatives, the rate of convergence is number of parameters divided by number of observations, log terms, if the tuning parameter is chosen appropriately, or you can put it other ways. You can also say, okay, I choose the tuning parameter like this, and then I look which oracle fits with this tuning parameter. Okay. Next example, Hardy-Kraus variation. Well, then you say the vector is actually a matrix, but you can put it in a vector, of course. This is like taking the sizes of these little squares. And here is the application of the theorem. So again, for proper choice of the tuning parameter, you get here the effective, well, again, this is the dimensionality of the problem, that's okay, and so on. You get effective sparsity, which now involves not distance between jumps, but areas around jumps. And here's an important reference for this. So I'm not going to use it. This is the dictionary for this Hardy-Kraus total variation, just half intervals. And this is an impression of what would be an interpolating vector. So these spikes are where the jumps are. They go up or down. And then I interpolate between them and make sure that I end at zero to avoid boundary effects. And here you interpolate downstairs. So that's the picture. And here you have, say, this matrix where the jumps are here, here, and so on. And there's a little bit arbitrariness here, but what you do is some kind of tessellation into rectangles. And you have to do it in the best possible way, in a sense, such that effective sparsity is small because it involves one over the areas here around a jump. That's this thing here, here. So if the jumps are on a regular grid, the rate of convergence for the prediction error is again number of parameters divided by number of observations, but there occurs another term, which is which you cannot neglect. Neglect is if the dimensionality is not finite, but may grow with n, and that's because in the higher dimensions, distances and areas are not the same thing. So they behave like this, one over s plus one. Okay. Anyway, if the dimension is two, you get a square root s plus one. And in the worst case for higher dimensions, it can also be extended. What you get here is an S plus one instead of square root. So the would be the number of parameters squared divided by numbers of observations, which is still adaptive, but not the usual, what you would like. So let me ask, how much time do I have?
15 more minutes.
15? Okay, that's nice. So this is my final example, total variation on graphs. So now we consider a graph with vertices and edges. And the number of nodes is n. And now we observe on each node a vector y, which has a mean, unknown mean, and there's noise, just like before. And the total variation is just the differences between adjacent nodes. And when we minimize least squares estimator plus total variation regularization. Now we've seen that everything goes through, but the only thing is now you have to deal with the noise. And for the noise, we use the dictionary, this blue thing, psi. And before the examples which I showed so far, that was easy because there's only one possible choice for the dictionary. And roughly speaking, it's like this. If the analysis matrix is invertible, you can say, okay, if I write this as B, then I can write F in terms of the coefficients B just by inverting D. And then D inverse is like a global dictionary. And the dictionary we use then is that we project the columns of the global dictionary onto this null space, or the anti-projection of that. And of course, with graphs, if they have cycles, that doesn't work because there are several choices for the dictionary. So how do we choose a dictionary? First, just without aiming at adaptivity, but just look at the whole graph. So if you have a node and another node, so a node V and a node V prime, you can choose a path between the two nodes in the graph. And then the dictionary is just for a fixed V. You go to all other nodes, and then you just count how many times you pass an edge. And that gives you your dictionary. So here is a graph. You go from V to all other nodes. So then you have to pass this edge twice. And then you normalize by 1 over n. And that's an element in the vector for the edge E. And you do that for all nodes and all edges. Then you get indeed some kind of representation of F in terms of a dictionary with coefficients, the things you're interested in, so these increments. Yes, and then I have to say, this is already projecting. You subtract the overall mean, because that's, of course, not penalized. So you project on the constant term, and then you look at the end. This is the anti-projection on the constant term, okay? So for that, you need your dictionary. So the without thinking about adaptivity, the global noise weights would be just the length of these dictionary vectors, where they are for each edge. You look at all these paths which pass through such edges. And then you have to take the paths in such a way that this, these noise weights are small. So you don't want to use any edge too often. So that's global. If you have an F which is in this null space, that means that it's piecewise constant. So it's piecewise constant on certain subgraphs. And the jumps just disconnect these subgraphs. So you can do what I just told you on the subgraphs. You can just look at paths between nodes and count how often you need a certain edge. And that gives you your dictionary. Yeah, so you look at the anti-projections are now just subtract the mean within a subgraph. And then look for that for a dictionary. And this dictionary is just counting how often you use certain edges. Okay, so we have a dictionary here, and the question is how to choose it. Because there are several paths. If there are cycles, there are several paths. So let's do that for the grid. So for the grid, we choose a node, and we look at all possible paths to all other nodes, and count how often we need this edge. And an economical way to do that is just to take straight lines to the other nodes, but of course you have to stay on the grid. So that's maybe call that grid lines. Now just, I'll be quick here, just not to keep you busy too long. But there are several ways to choose these paths. And if you do it economically, you're fine with the overall maximal noise weights, but sometimes it makes sense to do it not very economically, to make a little detour, because you want the noise weights to be small near the boundary. Because of you want this interpolation, and this interpolation has to be smooth somehow. So you can calculate just by counting how often edges are used. You can count, you can somehow compute these noise weights depending on whether you take detours or not. And what's involved is important is this distance between an edge and the boundary. So I'm thinking now of this simple picture, but it's true in general. So if you take a direct route, so no detours, you will find that the number of times you use a certain path, then normalized, is logarithmic. So it's quite small, but the effective sparsity is quite large. And that's because there are such huge noise weights also near the active point. So all you can do is take a interpolating vector q, which is zero, and then jumps and goes back to zero, and then jumps down and goes back to zero and jumps up. So it just keeps on jumping, and otherwise it's zero, but there will be square root n jumps. So the effective sparsity will be large. And then, you have here a term of order 1 over square root of n. That's just lambda squared, huh? This term, times the effective sparsity will be 1 over square root of n. And this is also a minimax type of result. This is also in this paper by Hütter and Rigolet. But if you take little detours, you will find that the maximal noise weight is larger, but near the boundary they are smaller, so your effective sparsity will be smaller. So what you will do is you have an interpolating polynomial which goes nice smoothly to these sine vectors, goes up like that, and so d transpose q, the derivative, so to speak, is nicer, and that's why the effective sparsity is much smaller. And then if you multiply those, lambda squared times effective sparsity, you get a term involving n to the power 3 over 4. So that's quicker than 1 over square root of n, but there are of course log terms. And this is also a result found by Chatterjee and Goswami in their paper, I think, but they do use different techniques. Okay, so I'll come to the conclusion. So this is actually a work for the lasso, but in disguise. But you can see in these examples the dictionary is highly correlated, but still the lasso can be adaptive. I think these interpolating vectors are useful, but only if the problem has enough structure, like derivatives or higher order derivatives. And it leads to effective sparsity, which is an improvement of restricted eigenvalue conditions. And we have seen now that these total variation type penalties are adaptive. Just two remarks, you can extend things to other loss functions. For instance, what we did is logistic loss, just as an example, with binary observations. And you can also use these techniques to get rates for hidden layer neural networks. Just the techniques to get not adaptive rates, but non-adaptive rates, but at least rates for, one-layer ReLU networks in higher dimensions. Okay. Let me thank you very much for your attention and your patience. Thank you.
Thanks so much for the great talk.